Good morning, friends and colleagues. It is my pleasure to gather us back together again for this second lecture of the day. My name is Silas Allard. I serve as the Associate Director of the Center for the Study of Law and Religion. Allow me to add my welcome to you all in addition to that of our director, John Witte. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce our second lecturer, Professor Michael Welker. Professor Welker earned his doctorate in theology at Tübingen and a second doctor in philosophy at Heidelberg. He began his career teaching at Tübingen before moving to Münster, where he taught in Reformation theology, and then on to Heidelberg as a professor of systematic theology. He went to Heidelberg in 1991 and spent 22 years there teaching in systematic theology and establishing himself as John said earlier, one of the greatest Protestant theologians in the world, in one of the great seats of the Reformation. So as we celebrate the 500th anniversary, we are privileged to have Dr. Welker with us, bringing the wisdom and the history of Heidelberg with him to Emory. He now serves as senior professor at the University of Heidelberg and as director of the Center for International and Interdisciplinary Theology, which he also co-founded. And finally, Professor Welker is an ordained minister of long standing in the Protestant Church of the Palatinate. My apologies. In his 400 plus publications, Professor Welker has explored the doctrines of the Christ, creation, anthropology, and eschatology, including in his books God the Spirit, God the Revealed, Christology, Creation and Reality, and What Happens in Holy Communion. Note that this is only the smallest of samples. There are 51 other titles for you to explore after you are inspired by today's lecture. But in addition to his work in systematic theology, Professor Welker has also probed deeply the possibilities of interdisciplinary engagement for theology, especially the interaction of theology and science, theology and sociology, and theology and law, leading a multitude of projects that have built extensive networks of scholars across the globe and across the academic disciplines. In yet another area of his work, Professor Welker has taken on interdisciplinary biblical theology and analyzed forms of structured pluralism in the biblical canon, ecumenism, and late modern society. Deeply rooted in the Protestant theology of his native Germany, in the fertile soil of the Reformation, Professor Welker's scholarly imagination is boundaryless. He has taught many scholars what it means to be a great theologian and a great interdisciplinarian through his example of deep learning, a capacious mind, and a willing conversation. So it is not surprising that in light of this long list of accomplishments, Professor Welker has been recognized with full membership in the Heidelberg Academy of Sciences, corresponding membership in the Finnish Academy of Sciences, as well as an honorary doctorate from the University of Debrecen in Hungary, and another from Northwest University in South Africa. Finally, he has an honorary professorship at Seoul Theological University. A long list of honors and accomplishments. But finally, Professor Welker is no stranger to Emory University, and we are very honored that his extensive vitae includes fellow in our own Center for the Study of Law and Religion. Please join me in welcoming Professor Michael Welker to deliver his lecture, The European Reformation, Advocacy of Education.
Thank you very much for this all too kind introduction. I hope I can live up to the expectations that you rose. I'm very grateful for your kind invitation, in particular to John Witte and his colleagues and the staff from the Center for the Study of Law and Religion, the Kendall School of Theology, and of course, the Agape Foundation, your father, and the family, McDonald family. It's a great privilege and a great joy to be here. Over the last years, 47 international Reformation scholars explored the profiles of 48 European Reformation cities and their reformers in order to produce a richly illustrated book under the title Europa Reformata, European Reformation Cities and Their Reformers, including six female reformers. So this was published last year. It's already in the second edition. The English translation is out, and the Korean is coming up soon. Many of the insights that we gained are, of course, familiar, at least to many educated Christians. But we also gained sharper and more illuminating views on crucial issues of the Reformation. In the following, I should like to present some of these insights to you. 12 short points, 45 minutes. First, a revolution in education. The importance of the printing press for the Reformation. One simply cannot overestimate the importance of what at the time was the still relatively new technology of movable type printing for the success of the Reformation, especially with regard to the production of pamphlets and books in the vernacular. Between 1518 and 1530, 12 years, no fewer than 457 printings of Luther's writings, with an overall print run of 500,000 copies, appeared in Augsburg alone. 12 years, 457 printings, 500,000 pre-media time. Publishers and printing shops were enormously successful in many, many cities. Augsburg was only one of many places. Basel, Emden, Hamburg, Herborn, Hermannstadt, Sibiu, Kronstadt, Leiden, Nürnberg, Speyer, Stockholm, Ulm, Urach, Vienna, Worms, and other locales. So everywhere, big, big, successful publishing houses. Pamphlets, often with gripping illustrations, shook people up. Printed sermons and tractates made it possible to disseminate the Reformation message directly among the people. Catechism summarized the most important elements of faith and were disseminated far and wide, in part even globally. Translations of the Bible into the language of the people swiftly appeared in many countries. New congregational hymns and even entire hymnals were printed. Many reformers distinguished themselves through their extraordinary rhetorical and creative talents. Several, often supported by teams of translators, produced Bible translations that in their own turn determinatively influenced the development of local languages. Martin Luther in Germany, William Tyndale in England, Pierre-Robert Olivetan in France, Casiodoro de Reina in Spain, the Petri brothers in Sweden, Michael Agricola in Finland, Caspar Caroli in Hungary, and Primo Struve in Slovenia. Johannes Bugenhagen's translation of the Bible into Low German provided the model for the Danish Bible. The list of such linguistically seminal accomplishments could easily go on, an explosion of productivity and genius. Second, Reformation advocacy of education and liberation. At the time, enthusiasm for the Reformation was born largely by an educated middle class with a pronounced emancipatory disposition. Yet even before the Reformation, larger towns as centers of both news and communication were already providing the backdrop for educational movements. About 40% of the population in Nuremberg, for example, could already read. In some towns, circles of educated persons met who not only were attracted by the humanist ideals of Erasmus of Rotterdam, but were also open to the Reformation. To put it simply with the Göttingen historian Bernd Müller, no humanism, no Reformation. These circles, often with a broad network of correspondents, both disseminated and otherwise promoted Reformation doctrine. But it was not just in larger towns that the Reformation was able to gain a foothold. Devout rulers also joined and began supporting it in their own territories, and ultimately the Reformation spread to every class in the population. As an educational movement, The Reformation put great value in founding schools and hohe Schulen, schools of higher learning, and in renewing the educational system in the broader sense from the ground up. The impetus behind this extraordinary commitment was the will to promote universal access to the Bible as the Word of God. And by educating all people, not just the clergy, to promote a sound community in which human freedom could flourish. Portraits of numerous towns vividly illustrate these developments. In Schwäbisch Hall, for example, Johannes Brenz taught in his own writings that children were to be esteemed and respected and demanded the development of more empathetic pedagogical methods. Brenz founded German and Latin schools for both boys and girls of all classes in those days. In 1526, in Nuremberg, similarly inspired by Melanchthon, a new type of school altogether was created, the gymnasium, secondary school. And finally, in 1541, the reformer Johannes Honterus founded the first humanist gymnasium in Southeast Europe. In 1527, Philip of Hesse in Marburg founded the first Protestant university. The Hohe Schule in Herborn was developed as an educational institution not only for theology, but also for philosophical, jurisprudential research and teaching. Dynamic young scholars and erudite teachers from other European countries accepted appointments at various universities, contributing not inconsiderably to these institutions' ability to attract students from all over Europe and enhancing their interdisciplinary renown. In Heidelberg, for example, we had systematic theologians from France and Italy teaching. For these developments, the Reformation provided an enduring source of energy and inspiration for early modern universities in the fields of theology, philology, historiography, jurisprudence, and political science. This intensified and enhanced educational climate, together with the will to support and sustain it, similarly contributed to a fortification of people's self-consciousness in the broadest sense, which at least over time promoted change with respect to freedom also in the political sphere. Members of the clergy enthusiastically embraced the new ecclesiastical and theological freedom. Legal scholars sensed the potential of political freedom and were keen on putting these theories into actual practice. And even the mercantile upper classes, tradesmen, and the guilds participated in emergent Reformation developments, intent in their own turn on helping secure and solidify the newly acquired freedom. At the same time, such developments often served to strengthen previously existing anti-clerical attitudes among the various strata of society. With the clergy's political, economic, and taxation privileges now coming under fire or even being eliminated entirely. The message was clear. This yearning for a radical renewal of the church could no longer be repressed. The new technical means of printing and disseminating ideas and the enthusiasm for education and freedom among many people alone, however, do not explain the vigor and the glory of the Reformation. There are spiritual and theological messages and insights that ignited the fire of the Spirit in Europe. Third point, the spiritual heart of the Reformation: trust in the reality of God and God's revelation. The most famous and most beloved hymn of the Reformation, created by Martin Luther, follows Psalm 46. One of the more than 70 translations into English, Frederick Hedge, reads, "A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate on earth is not his equal." The Reformation message is characterized by a profound trust in God, the reality of God, not just a God thought, or a God idea, or a religious feeling. God and God's might allow for fearlessness in the face of human power. The alternatives the Reformation articulates are quite clear. God's word before human words, if necessary, even against human words. Biblical witnesses before human doctrines. God's truth before human certainties or opinions. Faith in redemption that cannot be attained through one's own actions, but rather solely through God, against trust in indulgences and one's own work. Point four, trust in the mighty and merciful presence of Jesus Christ and his reign. The famous Reformation hymn continues, "Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord saveth is his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle." The Reformation emphasizes that God has turned compassionately towards human beings, and that precisely this action on God's part is what is revealed in Jesus Christ and grasped in faith. God, God's word, and God's truth draw near to human beings, seeking to comfort, uplift, ennoble, and free them. God reveals himself in the compassionate, suffering human being, Jesus Christ, who was executed on the cross. Low Christology. Jesus Christ seizes his witnesses in the power of the Holy Spirit and enables them to partake in his life and authority, even against the power of Pope and Emperor. High Christology. Point five, sharp reactions against the disturbing of the Reformation and already the so-called pre-Reformation movements. As was to be expected, especially when the Reformation did not enjoy the protection of a territorial ruler, various forms of opposition against the Reformation and its followers quickly emerged, including persecution and even public execution. The Reformation movement proper was from the very outset also a movement of martyrs. Indeed, in some locales, especially in southern Europe, Sevilla, Valladolid, Venice, Protestants could sustain their faith only as crypto-Protestants, that is, as underground Protestants organizing themselves in secret networks. The Reformation's stirring theological insights and life-changing energy are today associated especially with the towns of Wittenberg, Luther and Melanchthon, Zurich, Zwingli and Bullinger, and Geneva, Calvin and Theodor Beza, with the developments commencing after 1517. Luther posts his 95 theses against the practice of indulgence in Wittenberg, or at least sends them to the authorities. And yet more than a century earlier than the Reformation in Germany, Switzerland, and other European countries, reform initiatives and the articulation of several key Reformation insights prompted the demand for corresponding reforms, especially in broader sphere in the universities at Oxford, especially from Wycliffe, and Prague, from Jan Hus, and indeed earlier, from Petrus Waldes, from Lyon and the Waldenses. It's interesting how important the universities were for this development, pre-Reformation and in the Reformation. So I think religion and academy is a strong point. Such Reformation forerunners, many claim today that they should be seen much more in their own right and not called pre-Reformation movements, should be seen in their own right. They were already emphasizing that God's grace alone constitutes the foundation of human salvation, and that the status of the Holy Scriptures was higher than any church doctrine. For just that reason, they argued, not only should the Bible be made accessible to all people, It should also be preached and its teaching communicated in the country's native language. Emphasis was on human maturity, on human beings having come of age in spiritual matters. And it was demanded that the Eucharist be distributed accordingly on the bread and wine to all congregational members. Even before later Reformation figures, several of these reformers were publicly executed for having disseminated these notions, which were indeed liberating, but considered heretical. Point six, Reformation and the sharing power, the involvement of city councils, guilds, and kings. Even prior to the Reformation, secular authorities were becoming increasingly interested in expanding their oversight and control of ecclesiastical spheres and concerns. Indeed, in some locales, councils even received papal support, or at least tolerance in this regard. The Pope even granting the council in Bern, for example, the right to appoint ecclesiastical office holders, even before the Reformation. In many locales, politicians used Reformation successes to expand the scope of their own power. In Augsburg, for example, where 90% of the citizens quickly became Protestant, the town council and laypersons took over the task of appointing ecclesiastical office holders, educating disputes in matters of faith, and ensuring that sermons adhered to scripture and were of a Protestant orientation. Cautious maneuvering on the part of some town councils with respect to the uncertainty of the legal status in the empire, for example in Augsburg, Speyer, Worms, though also in certain Swiss towns and in Latvia, was in some instances able to promote peaceful and even biconfessional arrangements, situations in which groups and church communities of Protestants could coexist with those members of the old faith, sometimes even for the long term. In other places, a hesitatingly de facto emergence of division of power between church and political authorities, though also legal and scholarly bodies, was unfortunately hindered by monarchical actions. In Copenhagen and Stockholm, for example, the king exploited Reformation enthusiasm to rid himself of opponents from among the nobility and upper citizenry, or to have himself consecrated in a quasi-religious fashion, and then arrogate to himself the corresponding authority. In Lyon, Huguenots, under the influence of Pierre Viret, tried through the use of violence to turn the town into a second Geneva. Especially among some Roman Catholic authors, such developments fueled the view that the Reformation utterly disempowered the church and surrendered control to political authorities. What in fact emerged, however, was a gradual process of division of power. Religion, politics, law, academy, scholarship, education, and a commitment to an ecumenical search for truth that turned out to be compatible with a more globally receptive and open piety, on the one hand, and an enhanced focus on freedom and democracy in later developments on the other. Point seven, public theology. The import of sermons and disputations. The Reformation was, as Bernd Hamm, an Erlangen historian, named it, the Reformation was a reading and preaching movement. Even the worship service was now to serve spiritual, ethical, and political education. Questions of faith and ecclesiastical political circumstances were to be stated and discussed freely and openly. Town councils in many locales embraced the Reformation message and accordingly promoted theologically and biblically informed sermons according to God's word. I mentioned this already. Public reaction to these developments was strong and positive. Disputations played an important role in spreading new Reformation ideas, in which regard Luther's famous Heidelberg disputation of 15 18 can serve as a kind of model, although this was only semi-public. It was through these disputations that Luther, focusing intently and unswervingly on God's revelation in Jesus Christ, excited and won over numerous future reformers. Other important disputations in the 1520s included those in Zurich, Breslau, Memmingen, Nuremberg, Hamburg, Stockholm, Bern, Flensburg, Ulm, and as one colleague put it in our article on Memmingen, in all public or semi-public disputations during the 1520s, defenders of the old faith inevitably ended up having to withdraw in defeat. Point 8, catechism, church ordinances, innovations in ordinary life. In many locales, adaptation of the Reformation was accompanied by the emergence of church ordinances and catechisms designed to provide reliable orientation in both life and doctrine. Over time, Luther's small and large catechisms, 1528-29, the Heidelberg Catechism, later 1563, though certainly also Thomas Cranmer's Book of Common Prayer, 1549, all became perennial spiritual bestsellers throughout the world. Yet even catechisms that today remain relatively unknown often exerted enormous influence. The most important of the three catechisms by Johannes Brenz from Schwäbisch Hall, 1535, went through 500 printings. Not too bad. Reformers focused not merely on renewing church life and doctrine in the narrower sense, but also on improving the culture of social services and assistance. For example, the care for the poor, services to the ill, care for orphans. Reformers largely transferred care for the poor from ecclesiastical to secular oversights. In Hamburg and elsewhere, a fund was established to address the need of the poor and the ill, overseen by 12 citizen deacons. Wolfgang Huber mentioned that. The reorganization of church institutions, of school systems, and of institutions of social services, for example, hospital, was buoyed and sustained by a spirit of Christian fellowship. In Constance, Ambrosius Blara drafted exemplary ordinances for reorganizing monastic life and implementing worship services that were commensurate with scripture, whether through the reorganization of existing structures or the adaptation of completely new forms. Initiatives for concrete aid for the poor emerged in many locales, often as a reaction to acute crises. For example, in connection with the demise of the textile industry in Leiden and Memmingen, or after storm surges in Witmarsum. Point 9. Princesses, female reformers, and young theologians and Jews in leadership roles. Theologically and spiritually engaged princesses and educated women from the upper classes of the citizenry made important contributions to the Reformation. The Queen of Navarre, Margaret of Angoulême, and her daughter, the Duchess of d'Albret, in the Principality of Bern, Pau, Jeanne d'Albret, promoted simultaneous churches, that is, churches that opened Roman Catholic church buildings to Protestant preachers. In contact with reformers in Geneva, they assisted in reforming church institutions and the principality itself, and in efforts to purify the worship service. In cosmopolitan Emden, Countess Anna of East Friesland appointed as senior spiritual administrator the Polish humanist and Reformation theologian Johannes Alasko, charging him with reorganizing the entire church and its institutions in East Friesland. New synodal leadership committees were created, and in Emden itself, leaders organized religious colloquies with those who were still adherent to the old faith and with peaceable Anabaptists. So here you have already first steps in ecumenism. And it's very interesting that particularly women helped to have peaceful developments and even sharing churches between the believers of the old faith and the Protestants. At the court of Ferrara, René de France promoted interests in Protestant ideas in a circle of ladies and gentlemen of the nobility. One of the most genteel family in Constance, the Blaras, was captivated by the educational ideals of humanism and inspired by the Protestant spirit. The Blara siblings, acquainted with both Melanchthon and Luther, endeavored not only to renew the church and school system, but also to improve the care for the poor. Margarete Blara, whom no less a personage than Erasmus of Rotterdam publicly praised, began a correspondence with Martin Bucer and became personally engaged on behalf of impoverished women and orphans, as well as in care for the sick. In 1523 in Strasbourg, Katharina Zell not only became one of the first Protestant clergymen's wives, as the wife of the preacher at the Strasbourg Cathedral, but also a distinguished Reformation writer. She defended publicly the abolition of celibacy, as well as adducing as support the biblical testimony to the effects of the Holy Spirit, the right of women to speak and play a determinative role in spiritual matters. She became engaged for refugees of faith, not only by providing practical assistance, but also through letters of consolation and encouragement. She published a hymnal reflecting the spirituality of the Bohemian Brothers and defended peaceable Anabaptists against public persecution. Wonderful, another example, female powers provided steps towards ecumenical freedom. The spirit of the Reformation was finally also characterized by the considerable influence exerted by energetic young theologians and jurists, who often immediately after concluding their university studies assumed key leadership roles in doctrinal matters, proclamation and church administration and governance. Distinguished examples include, of course, Philip Melanchthon and John Calvin, though also numerous other young reformers such as Martin Calmanci in Santa in Debrecen, Johannes Honterus and Valentin Wagner in Kronstadt, Johannes Brenz in Schwäbisch Hall, Michael Diller in Speyer, Michael Agricola in Turku, Hans Tausen in Viborg, and Zwingli in Bullinger in Zurich. So the younger generation against gerontocratic systems. 10.10, European internationality. The small town of Wittenberg became the center of the civilized world, writes one colleague, from which a new religious culture radiated out in all directions. The only recently founded university, founded in 1502, with its renowned teachers, Luther and Melanchthon, attracted more than 4,700 students from all over Europe between 1535 and 1545. Not only the two stars, but certainly also the two. 10 years, 4,700 students, making Wittenberg the most populous university in the empire. Distinguished artists as well, however, explicitly from the school of Lukas Cranach, similarly extended the Reformation's aura far beyond merely Germany. Other institutions of higher learning where Reformation doctrine was represented similarly attracted students and scholars from all over Europe. Heidelberg, Marburg, Herborn, though also Cambridge, were especially successful in this regard. Alongside the attraction of theological, jurisprudential, and humanist educational opportunities, however, was also the persecution and resultant floods of refugees that contributed across borders to education and exchange, and to the increasingly international and interconnectedness of life. Towns such as Emden and Frankfurt am Main, by accepting refugees from other countries, thereby also enhanced their own economic and cosmopolitan aura. Students and teachers, though also persons serving the church who, because of issues of faith, had to leave their country and flee, acquired cultural and linguistic skills that similarly enabled them to pass along the new ideas in the most varied contexts. Cosmopolitan towns with a long local tradition and great power, such as the Republic of Venice or Edinburgh, though also locales characterized by multiple ethnic groups, such as Kronstadt and Turku, were stimulated anew through the often contentious exposure to the Reformation spirit, which at once also subjugated their previous cultivation of tradition and fixed cultural routines to constructed endurance tests. So it's both, you know, these cultural fuzzy situations gained impact, but also these very sterile traditions were challenged by all these developments. Point 11, thematic conflicts with the Roman Church. Not surprisingly, copious thematic issues generated conflicts between the Reformation and the Roman Church. Although many people today view the Reformation as having been initiated or set into motion by the sale of indulgences, that particular theme was but one among many. The central theme prompting this new religious embarkation was the Reformation's disagreement with regnant speculative and metaphysical theology and its concomitant understanding of a detached and abstract God. Luther's Heidelberg disputation of 1518 broke completely new ground from which to criticize a theology that did not grant absolutely normative status to God's revelation in Jesus Christ and to a focused orientation toward the biblical witnesses. Whereas the new theology, oriented now towards Jesus Christ and on the Holy Scriptures, was intent on enabling all people to gain access to the sources of knowledge of God, speculative and metaphysical theology now seemed exposed to a theology exclusively for those who ruled and who sought even more power to rule. The new theology also severely called into question the powerful practice of confessions as well as celibacy. Yet another controversial topic during the Reformation was the traditional church's refusal to offer the Eucharist to the congregation in its two forms, bread and wine, sub utraque. The Reformation objected this position that this position clearly contradicts the witness of Scripture. The Reformation similarly rejected other themes as being non-biblical or as exaggerations with little or no direct biblical support, including the cult of Mary and the saints, the transmission of legends of the saints, the rosary, the doctrine of purgatory. It also demanded the abolition of the Mass held in Latin, processions, the excessive imagery in churches, and the often numerous secondary altars. Such objections and disputes were often particularly vehement precisely when unjustified economic privilege and the obvious cultivation of a double morality was associated with clerical hegemony. Conflicts similarly arose when social problems and poor educational opportunities were attributed to the inadequate leadership of the church itself. The notion of the priesthood of all believers provided support for those who criticized the questionable authority of the Pope, the hierarchical organization of the clergy, and the powerful status of monasteries. Teaching and proclamation that was focused solely on the Holy Scripture was to expel all obscurantism from the church. That was the hope. The dominance of church jurisdiction was called into question, and in many areas, education by secular authorities replaced canonical law and traditional dispensation of justice by the church. Many developments initiated by the Reformation anticipated that a division of power offered a more effective way of promoting individual and societal freedom. People began to see that such freedoms were best served when politics, the administration of justice, science and scholarship, and oversight of church and religious matters were not concentrated in a single entity. Last point, inner Protestant thematic conflicts. As early as 1520, conflicts arose between Luther and the very man who, alongside Luther, many between 1518 and 1522, considered one of the most important representatives of Wittenberg's Reformation theology, namely Luther's own doctoral advisor, Andreas Rudolf Bodenstein, known as Karlstadt, from the Franconian town of Karlstadt. The initial issue concerned the inviolability of the biblical canon. Luther had questioned the canonical validity of the letter of James, which in Luther's view advocated righteousness through works. His colleague Karlstadt sensed here a threat to the authority of the Holy Scriptures. The two men also came into conflict concerning infant baptism and the appropriate age for baptism, though also concerning the presence of Jesus Christ in the Eucharist. Karlstadt, influenced by mystical theology much more than Luther, emphasized more radically than Luther the maturity of the individual Christian and the authority of the congregation, even without the crucial prerequisite of education and training that was so important for Melanchthon and Luther. In his church community in Orlamünde, as Brother Andreas, he developed a ministry that emphasized the importance of all laypersons for all ecclesial activities. These and other themes generated inter-Protestant conflicts that, along with social conflicts and the accompanying tensions, aggravated and exacerbated the contentious arguments. The dispute concerning Christ's presence in the Eucharist turned into one of the central conflicts between Lutherans and Reformed. In Marburg in 1529, after a debate that had started already in 26 and being carried on in polemic pamphlets, Philip of Hesse tried to find a middle ground between Lutherans and Zwinglians, as he said, albeit without success. Although an important step along this path was achieved with the Wittenberg Concord in 1536, created by Bucer and Melanchthon, it was not until the Leuenberg Concord of 1973 that inner Protestant reconciliation in this matter was achieved. Similarly, contentious conflicts arose in connection with spiritualist movements, which referred to the inner world of the Spirit and emphasizing the theological authority of the individual Christian, Sebastian Frank, Caspar von Schwenkfeld in Ulm, and with those who called into question central tenets of faith, the doctrine of the Trinity or Christ's divine nature. So in Venice, in Poland, Transylvania, Zavid, in Geneva, and others generated these conflicts. Conflicts similarly arose in connection with the rejection of infant baptism and the performance of the rite of baptism of adults, which not infrequently was accompanied by the willingness to undergo anabaptism. These conflicts came to a head with a framework of emancipatory and ultimately violent protest movements that also directed their anger toward oppressive economic and existential abuses and situations of acute distress. Mühlhausen, Münster, Memmingen, and other locales became centers of such radicalization. In the spring of 1525, in Upper Swabia, in the religious center of gravity Memmingen, the largest uprising in Europe prior to the French Revolution commenced. Presumably 50,000 rebellious peasants demanded in 12 articles the abolition of serfdom, the right of the congregation to choose their own pastor, and the replacement of the hegemony of the nobility and ecclesiastical princes by a common government, and the implementation of other freedoms and privileges. Thousands of peasants perished in battles with the troops of the nobility. The Reformation historian Heiko Obermann was inclined to assert that Memmingen, in fact, represented a fourth center of the Reformation alongside Wittenberg, Zurich, and Geneva. Radical Anabaptist movements, for example in Münster, where the tailor Jan van Leyden had himself declared king, thereafter abolishing, among other things, money, and imposing the death penalty on those who transgressed against the Ten Commandments, and even arrogating to himself the right to choose the name of every newborn child. Such movements remained isolated incidents and yet were nonetheless able to damage the reputation of the Reformation. Indeed, even today, the unresolved relationship with Anabaptists, the Reformation's failure in connection with the peasants, though also the stubborn recurrence of anti-Semitism, all belong to the darker side of the Reformation. A movement that is markedly different from the violently inclined peasants and the equally violently inclined opponents is represented, as we all know, by the Mennonites, who even today continue to embody a rigorous and consistent theology and ethics of peace, Menno Simons in Witmarsum as a key person. Such Reformation highlights include countless other examples of nonviolent resistance and efforts on behalf of a peaceful ecumenical coexistence. Many locales, after dramatic show trials, public executions, and burnings, and even posthumous condemnations with public burnings of coffins, the dead. Not just one place. Antwerp, Augsburg, Edinburgh, Ferrara, Oxford, and other places loved to burn these coffins. They became temporary or even permanent places in which refugees of faith from many different countries could find a safe harbor. So we saw these ugly, violent developments, but then also counter developments. Protestants in Augsburg, after their churches were confiscated, I told you 90% Protestants in Augsburg, then their churches were confiscated, following their impressive initial successes, patiently and peacefully conducted their worship services for 14 years out in the open air. Accounts from other locales similarly relate how Protestants marched outside the town gates to their worship services. Even as late as 1649, we have an engraving of Hernals Castle near Vienna by Matthias Merian, the Protestants marching out. The turbulent emergence of the Reformation was followed in many countries by long periods of hardship and patience on the road to a peaceful ecumenical life, enduringly inspired by the Reformation. Thank you very much.
So we are left with a few minutes for questions. We do have the two microphones here, so I invite anyone who would like to put a question to Professor Welker.
Lawyers are never at a loss for words. Could you tie your conversation about education to Professor Huber's conversation about vocation and talk a bit about how the reformers saw the educational system in the cultivation of the individual's understanding of calling or vocation?
Well, I think this is a formidable example for what Wolfgang rightly put, the formation of the person, the formation of personality. But again, not an abstract a personality, but what Luther would call a personality bound in God's words. Yeah. So it was education centered on the divine revelation and a critical and self-critical examination of one's own faith and the communication with others. Many people love this quote of Luther, "Here I stand." We don't know whether Luther had said this, but what he certainly said was, if I'm not convinced by arguments from scripture and overt reason, I am bound. So, and I think these kind of educational, emancipatory, communicative actions that then do not only relate to one's faith, but also to one's environments in the economy, in the social services and so on, was at the heart. So it was a very powerful package deal that we see here. It's very, very important not to reduce it to just one principle or one idea. And I think at the heart is really very often overlooked this challenge of the scholastic theology, metaphysical theology, and revelation in Christ and the radiating powers. And then you get also this ethos of love and ethos of justice and mercy and so on, and then it radiates into the other spheres of the society.
Could I ask you to make a point about what becomes science? Was that at all an awareness in the municipalities? In other words, how would you put any kind of points on the evolution of science here?
Yeah. The brilliant mathematician and physicist Alfred North Whitehead said we had two very powerful developments coming out of Renaissance, both emphasizing the importance of critical and self-critical experience. One was the Reformation, and the other were the modern sciences. And I think this vigor of igniting the development of the university, the beginning of the modern university, has to do with this passion for an experience-based investigation of the divine and the natural things.
Humanism was necessary or prerequisite for the Reformation. Could you elaborate on that specifically? Also, the opponents of Luther were also humanists, a great many of them as well. How was that connection between the Reformation and Erasmus and humanism?
Yeah. Well, the emphasis of the humanist was already education, was already autonomy of human beings to judge also on spiritual manners, was an emphasis on translation, on putting the word of God in the hands of the people by good translations and preaching and teaching in the native language and so on and so on. So these are all enormous powers that were taken up by the Reformation. I think what Luther brought in was this radicality of the Christological concentration and the low Christology, that God wants to be revealed in what he turned to the human beings and not in the invisible. He argued against the die Scholastiker, die sich in die Geheimnisse der Gottheit einschleichen wollen. So the scholastic that want to creep into the mysteries of the divine. And I think this was not only a matter of theology, that was also a challenge to the powers. Because those who controlled the spiritual realm then also told people, by the indulgence. And not only the indulgence for your previous sins, also for the future sins. We now know that the indulgences for the rich were 9,000 euro, converted into today's thing. For the middle class, it was 3,000, and they had also lesser for the poor people, and I think the reformers saw that this was connected to eine Unmündigkeit, how do you call it, when people are not able to have a firm judgment on their own, and this they shared with the humanists, of course.
I'm very impressed, Michael, by the way in which the project Europa Reformata enriches our picture of the Reformation. That's very, very impressive. And the way in which you condensated that to 12 points was very, I'm very, very grateful for that. Compared with that, I have a limited, but however, for me, myself, disturbing question. You made clear that the Reformation was a movement of martyrs. And then it comes back to mind that the Reformation itself proclaimed a way of the church sine vi et verbo, yeah. without force, only by the word.
Yeah.
And the Reformation, and you made it clear at your last point, was not consistent with this position. And I would like to provoke you to comment on this ambiguity and how we deal with that now celebrating 500 years of Reformation.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the famous formula, simul justus et peccata, was not just a lip service, but I think it was a clear insight that even under the good powers that are indispensable for human life, politics, law, religion, common sense, common ethos, we live in a world that sees both flourishing and corruption. And I think the most important insight-generating point in the whole biblical canon is the cross of Christ. And I think here the Reformation needs more supplementation than just the suffering God. I think the suffering God is a very important topic. But the cross also reveals the world under the power of sin. Rome, and if you want to imagine Rome today, the superpower, you have to bring together China, Russia, and US. But also the resisting religion, referring to both the Mosaic law and the Roman law. Corrupted public opinion. Today, Hosanna, tomorrow, crucify him. And even the disciples. Here you see the whole world under the power of sin. And I think that for a self-critical, prophetic engagement, we have to make clear that we are all in danger to then overstep the good boundaries given us by law, spirit, and ethos of love, forgiveness and mercy, and so on. So I think that it wasn't, I would not go as far to say that it was a lust of violence on the reformers. There might have been minorities. But it was also sometimes a situation of desperateness where you have the feeling, well, now we have to fight against it. I think it is very important to get this sober attitude, and this is not the abstract problem of the law under the power of sin, but the very concrete, that our ethics, our religion, our law, our politics, all can become corrupted and can turn into very vicious powers. So this would be my first point to try to deal with that. And here, of course, there is a lack of self-critique. And you also mentioned Luther's ethos of Beruf as a more conservative thing. I have difficulties. I also have difficulties with the verse from this famous hymn, Nehmen Sie den Leib, gut ihr Kind und Weib, lass fahren dahin, Sie haben keinen Gewinn, das Reich muss uns zerbleiben. If they take my body, if they take my possession, if they take my wife, my children, let them go. Yeah? The reign of God is with us. I think these are statements where we should not piously follow and say, well, I sign everything the Reformation has said.